Good afternoon. Welcome to the Water Research Foundation Webcast, Localized Treatment for Disinfection By-Products. My name is Xiaowen Chen, and I'm the Project Manager with the Water Research Foundation. I will be the moderator for today's session. As you know, compliance with Stage 1 Disinfectants Disinfection By-Products Rule, or DBPR, is determined by the running annual average of samples from all monitoring locations. Stage 2 DBPR, however, will require compliance at all sampling locations. One way to deal with this issue is to treat water at hotspots, which means that the either THM or HAS5 is over the MCL. It was the objective of Project 3103, Localized Treatment for Disinfection By-Products, to investigate an innovative approach to reduce or remove BBPs from a drinking water distribution. Project 3103 was a tailored collaboration project co-funded by the Water Research Foundation, the Las Vegas Valley Water District, South Central Connecticut Regional Water Authority, and the City of Phoenix Water Services Department. The final products of this project are a project report and an Excel-based localized BBP treatment evaluation model, which comes with a user's manual. After the presentation, I will show you how to obtain the report and model. The webcast will highlight the results of Project 3103, as well as an in-house study conducted by the Las Vegas Valley Water District on managing water age and full-scale installation of an aeration system in a water storage reservoir in one of their hotspots. Our presenters today in order of presentation are Dr. Bruce Johnson, Senior Project Manager at CH2M Hill in Las Vegas, Laura Jacobson, Planning Manager at the Las Vegas Valley Water District, Mao Fang, Senior Civil Engineer at the Las Vegas Valley Water District, and Joseph Lin, Staff Engineer at CH2M Hill in Las Vegas. Before I turn this over to Bruce, I would like to remind viewers that following the presentation, there will be a question and answer session. You can enter your questions directly through the webcast webpage during and after the presentation. If we are unable to get to everyone's questions during today's webcast, we will provide answers to those questions, which will be available along with the full download of the entire webcast on the Water Research Foundation website later this week. With that, I'd like to introduce Dr. Bruce Johnson.
Okay, well, thank you very much, and appreciate your joining us this afternoon. We hope that we'll have an informative and useful presentation to you as you look at the different options for complying with the disinfection byproduct regulations. I'd like to take just a minute here again to recognize the participants and the contributors on this project. Again, our project managers for the Water Research Foundation have been Xiaowen Chen and Mylin Nguyen. Also, the project advisory committee included Ina Babbitt, Robert Clark, and Zaid Chowdhury. Our technical advisory committee consisted of Brandy Kelso, Bruce Mackler, Andrea Seifert, Mike Wang, and Paul Westerhoff. And again, I'd like to again acknowledge the contributing utilities, Las Vegas Valley Water District, City of Phoenix, and the South Central Connecticut Regional Water Authority. As has already been indicated, there are four of us that will be speaking today. I'll give kind of a brief introduction to the project. Laura Jacobson will then follow me and give a overview of the attempts at the Las Vegas Valley Water District to reduce disinfection byproducts by managing water age. Joe Lynn from CH2M Hill will present the results of our pilot testing and the modeling of localized treatment. Mao Fang, then also from the Water District, will talk about what we've learned from the pilot testing and apply it to a full-scale application. And then I'll just give a real brief summary at the end. It's probably good to, at this point to just give a little bit of a recap again about the disinfection byproduct rules. And I'll use a little simple example here. Under the Stage 1 disinfection byproduct rules, it's possible to report the quarterly average from all sampling locations. In this simple illustration for TTHMs, the compliance limit is 80 micrograms per liter. You'll see that one of these samples is above 80 micrograms per liter, but when you average all four of them together, it's 68 micrograms per liter. And since the average is below the regulatory limit, then the system is in compliance. Now, under the Stage 2 rules, however, all sampling locations have to be reported. If any of the locations are above 80 micrograms per liter for THMs, the system's out of compliance. So if we use the same numbers as our previous illustration, we can see that for one of the sampling locations, it's 81 micrograms per liter, and so therefore the system is out of compliance. Now, if we look at the various solutions that might be available, and given the situation that we only have a few of the sampling locations out of compliance, there's several different approaches that we could consider. One of these is controlling water age. We could also provide localized treatment in the distribution system. We could provide treatment of DVPs, primarily precursors, at the central treatment plant, or we could provide alternative disinfections. This is a pretty big topic to try to hit on all four of these areas today, so we're going to just focus on the first two, managing water age and providing localized treatment. And so with that, I'll turn the time over to Laura Jacobson to discuss the experience that the Las Vegas Water District has had in managing water age.
Thank you, Bruce. One of the least expensive means of controlling disinfection byproducts for utilities is water age management. Different utilities will use different strategies to control water age depending on the configuration of their distribution system. So today I'll briefly present the Las Vegas Valley Water District's approach to water age management. This is an overview of the district's distribution system. The facilities shown in green are Southern Nevada Water Authority regional transmission pipelines, which convey water from its treatment plant at Lake Mead to various water utilities in the Las Vegas Valley. The Las Vegas Valley Water District receives its water from the regional system at 10 turnout locations, which are shown as orange squares on the map. The water is conveyed from turnouts to receiving reservoirs, where it is further pumped to storage reservoirs throughout the distribution system's 24 pressure zones. The district has 41 reservoirs shown as red dots on the map with a potential total of 916 million gallons of potable storage. Rechlorination facilities exist at most of these reservoirs. The maximum day demand in 2009 was 429 million gallons, so there's a fairly large amount of emergency storage available to the system. The blue lines represent the large diameter backbone pipelines in the distribution system, and the areas within the far west, northwest, and southwest are considered the remote areas of the system where water age is highest. Storage is maintained in the system for a variety of purposes. Emergencies such as fires, facility outages, and water main breaks are the first to come to mind. In addition, storage provides demand equalization for treatment plant production, limits pressure fluctuations experienced by our customers, and gives the district a great deal of flexibility in operating and maintaining its system. Finally, storage allows us to minimize our energy costs by pumping only during less expensive off-peak periods of the day. As water ages, water quality declines through chlorine decay and the formation of disinfection byproducts. Most of the aging in the district's distribution system occurs in the reservoirs. Without proper circulation and turnover, the quality of the stored water deteriorates. This graph depicts the high correlation between water age and THMs in the district's distribution system. The winter months are the district's worst case for THMs. The water demands in the winter are low, which corresponds to higher water age. The far right side of the graph depicts samples taken at the remote areas of our distribution system and show an apparent issue with high THMs. The majority of the system does not have a problem with THMs. A similar graph for HAAs indicates no apparent problem for the district system. The first technique used by the district to control DBP levels is to reduce water age through the use of operating strategies such as seasonal storage volume reduction, where we take portions of our storage out of service on a scheduled basis. We also have daily and weekly storage turnover goals, which are guided by the use of near real-time water age calculations, which are accomplished using a hydraulic model. The water age calculations are accomplished through the district's energy and water quality management system. An EWQMS is simply a collection of individual application software programs that solves energy and water quality problems. The district's EWQMS is an offshoot of another Water Research Foundation project, number 458, and it was spearheaded by our operations department. The district uses the EWQMS to reduce water age and reduce energy costs. The district uses a hydraulic model of its distribution system to prepare daily operating strategies and pumping plans with these goals in mind. And it also uses a variety of applications developed to monitor system performance. This would not be possible if the district's model, GIS, SCADA, and enterprise systems were not well integrated. While spatial and enterprise systems help build the foundation for the hydraulic model, for the purposes of EWQMS and water age calculations, it's the integration of the model with the SCADA system that is of particular importance. The water age of each reservoir is calculated based on an actual system operation and kept in a database. This allows water age calculations to stay current and provides feedback to operating plans for water age reduction. This is an example of the water age calculation output. Each line represents water age in one of the reservoirs in the district system. While the water age shown by the red and blue lines seems well under control, the green lines appears to have water age issues. And the green line represents a new reservoir in our system. And the chart begins at startup of the reservoir and its associated pumping station. The initial water age is high because pumping at this facility is limited due to startup operations, and this impedes our ability to turn the water over. Once the pumping station operations have been fine-tuned, we're able to employ strategies to reduce and stabilize water age. One of the things we noticed during our phase of rapid growth in the Las Vegas Valley is that some areas had high water age that could not be easily mitigated. These tended to be areas of growth where new major facilities had just been constructed, but few homes were occupied. And this slide tracks these hot spots from 2000 to 2004. The area outlined by a circle in the far north portion of the system illustrates the problem. During the initial phases of development, high water age occurred, but then diminished over the next 2 to 3 years as more homes were sold and occupied. The area outlined in a square in the southern portion of the system illustrates a similar pattern. While the area to the west had a more persistent water age issue, as the developer changed its development plans after the new facilities were constructed. And it's these hotspots that led to the district's interest in hotspot treatment and its participation in this Water Research Foundation project.
I got it, Laura.
Thank you. This slide continues to track our hotspots during the boom to bust cycle between 2004 and 2008. New facilities were being constructed at an accelerated pace, and at first the pattern we'd seen, where high water age diminished within a few years, continued, as you can see, between 2004 and 2006. But then the bottom fell out of the market. And while some areas continued to improve from 2000 through 2008, some facilities had been built that would not see the benefit of the hot real estate market. And the district realized that we may be facing a more persistent water age problem. Hotspots aside, the one thing that the district noted about water age reduction strategies was that there was only so much that could be accomplished in the remote areas of the distribution system. This graph compares THMs at the most remote reservoir in the system, shown in red, with the average THMs at the 10 most remote reservoirs in the system, which is shown in blue. And as you can see, the reservoir shown in red indicates a reduction in THM levels. The THMs in the blue reservoirs are nearly unchanged, despite our best efforts. And this illustrates the fact that once water age has been optimized throughout the distribution system, reducing water age at one facility can very often come at the expense of water age at another. Water age is a function of volume versus demand. So if the volume is as low as you're willing to go for a given demand condition, then the overall water age can't be further reduced. To summarize, the effectiveness of water age management through operating strategies may be limited due to system configuration, actual demands, and storage volume. Areas under development are problematic at early development stages. And the economic slowdown has further impacted the district's ability to reduce water age through operational strategies. Hotspot treatment needs to be part of the district's DVP control strategy. This would involve treatment of less than 10% of the district system, as opposed to other more centralized treatment technologies, which would treat 100% of the water. Our next speaker will be Joe Lynn, who will talk about the localized treatment pilot study.
Thanks, Laura. As Laura mentioned, water age management can be effective for lowering DVP levels in a distribution system. But for the Las Vegas Valley Water District and for other utilities, additional steps must be taken to comply with the Stage 2 DVP rule. One alternative to consider is to only treat the hot spots within the system by strategically placing treatment plants at pumping stations. This could significantly save costs because the utility would only need to treat a portion of their whole distribution system. Water RF Project 3103 is a pilot scale study to determine the effectiveness of this alternative. The project objectives were to evaluate the effectiveness of two types of treatment, air stripping and GAC-BAC, determine the DVP reformation potential after treatment, develop an Excel model of the treatment and reformation process, link this Excel model with existing hydraulic modeling software and develop cost estimating tools. First, we will discuss the pilot testing. The pilot plant location was chosen where the DBP concentrations were nearly exceeding the stage 2 DBP limits. Therefore, the Alta reservoir and pump station was chosen. As you can see, the TTHM levels previously reached 80 micrograms per liter. And as previously stated, the HAA5 concentrations for LVVWD is significantly below the 60 micrograms per liter limit. Key precursor concentrations include a TOC at 2.5 milligrams per liter and a free chlorine residual at 1 milligram per liter. Airstripping and GAC-BAC were examined in this pilot plant. These are pictures of the low-profile airstripper and the GAC-BAC column assembly used at the pilot plant. We had two treatment trains. Train 1 consisted of airstripping followed by GAC-BAC treatment. The influent water would first go through the airstripper. Then it would go through three columns in parallel, each with a 10-minute empty bed contact time. The first column did not have any chemical addition. The second column added sodium thiosulfate to dechlorinate the water. The third column added sodium thiosulfate and phosphate. Phosphate was used to help the promotion of bacteria in the column, thus converting the column from a GAC column to a BAC column. The S's represent sampling spots. The second train consisted of GAC-BAC treatment only. Instead of the columns being in parallel, they are placed in series, each with a 10-minute empty bed contact time for a total of 30 minutes. And this is a picture of the whole pilot plant assembled together. Now on to results. First, we will discuss airstripping treatment. This graph shows percent removal of TTHMs versus the air-water ratio used. Two main points come from this graph. First, it can be seen that the curves for the May 2006 and February 2007 lines are similar. This implies that seasonal differences did not alter the effectiveness of the air stripper. Second, at an air-to-water ratio of 45, 70 to 85% TTHM removal was achieved throughout the whole study. Thus, air stripping is an effective method of removing TTHMs. Now for other parameters with respect to air stripping. There was no significant removal of HAAs, chlorine, or TOC. The pH had a small average increase from 7.9 to 8.16. Now we will discuss GAC-BAC treatment. This graph shows percent removal of TTHMs versus the number of bed volumes. Two main points also come from this graph. First, GAC treatment achieved greater than 90% removal for the first 10,000 bed volumes. Second, removal gradually decreases, but still achieves 20 to 30% removal after 30,000 bed volumes. Now for HAA5 removal. This graph shows HAA5 concentration versus number of bed volumes. The top curve is the influent concentration, while the bottom curve is the GAC-BAC effluent concentration. The effluent concentration exhibits a bell-shaped curve. This can be explained in three steps. First, HAA5 was removed initially by absorption. Then, as absorption became less effective, biological activity began to build in the column. Finally, after 30,000 bed volumes, a full BAC column was formed, and HAA5 was fully removed. Besides the Las Vegas Valley Water District, we had two other participating utilities in this water RF project, the South Central Connecticut Regional Water Authority and the City of Phoenix. Both utilities provided additional data regarding GAC-BAC treatment. For the SEC RWA, A GAC filter was placed at the Grassy Hill pump station, and DBP concentrations were measured. The removal curves for both PTHM and HAA5 were similar to the curves produced by LVBWD's pilot plant. For the city of Phoenix, samples were taken from a hotspot in the utility's distribution system. They were then sent to CH2M Hill's Applied Sciences Laboratory, where samples were run through a GAC filter. Again, the removal curves for both TTHM and HAA5 were similar to the curves produced in the pilot plant. For the performance of other parameters, we had a small removal of TOC after the initial absorption. For chlorine, it has a redox reaction with the GAC. In fact, chlorine was fully removed within the first 2 minutes of empty bed contact time, even after 30,000 bed volumes. Last, pH values had no significant change. So to summarize the treatment of TTHM and HAA5, we saw that air stripping had good TTHM removal, GAC had good TTHM removal for the first 10,000 bed volumes and gradually lost effectiveness, and BAC had 100% HAA5 removal after 30,000 bed volumes. Now that we have looked at the treatment of TTHM and HAA5, we must now examine the reformation of these DBPs after treatment. So what do I mean exactly when I say reformation after treatment? Well, here's a schematic of what I mean. In this example, we have the effluent TTHM concentration from the water treatment plant of 40 micrograms per liter. After having some time to form TTHMs in the distribution system, the concentration has now reached 80 micrograms per liter prior to localized treatment. After localized treatment, the concentration is now at 30 micrograms per liter. Again, this is all an example. The $64,000 question is, after localized treatment, what will the TTHM concentration be at the end user? The ultimate goal is that DBP concentrations at the end user must be below the stage 2 DBP rule. To find out the concentrations at the end user, we conducted a simulated distribution system test. The results we found were very interesting. This is a graph of TTHM formation potential versus days of reformation. Just like my other graphs, I have 2 points to mention. First, look at the top two curves on this graph. The very top line is the formation curve without any treatment, and the other line is the formation curve for a blend of 25% treated water with 75% untreated water. The straight dotted line is the 80 micrograms per liter limit for TTHM. Unfortunately, it doesn't show very well on there, but as you can see, if we only treat 25% of the water, we can stay below the 80 microgram per liter limit even after 7 days of reformation. Thus, instead of treating the whole reservoir, only a portion of the reservoir may need to be treated. Please note that this was the case for the LVBWD and may not apply to your utility. Second, take a look at all of the curves. You will notice that they are somewhat parallel to each other. This implies that no precursors were significantly removed during treatment. Now that we have finished looking at treatment and reformation, our next goal was to produce an Excel model of treatment, reformation, and cost. For the treatment model development, air stripping has theoretical removal rates that can be determined using Henry's law constants. For GAC and BAC, there is existing empirical data that is little inconsistent. Thus, we produced an empirical model based off of that data collected in the pilot study. For the DBP reformation model development, we first looked at an EPA-published model produced by Dr. Gary Amy. Albeit a very effective model, it unfortunately could not be well incorporated into hydraulic models. Thus, we produced a first-order growth model that still incorporated some of the ideas of the Amy model, but was more user-friendly for hydraulic models. This first-order growth model requires that a simulated distribution system be run along with some curve fitting. Once we finished developing the treatment and reformation model, we applied it to LVVWD's hydraulic model. Before treatment, you can see the hot spot in question on the left-hand side. After treating only 50% of the reservoir's water at 80% removal, the hydraulic model shows that the hot spot is now gone. We also developed cost estimating tools. Capital and O&M costs were developed for each type of localized treatment and can be compared to centralized treatment. We can see the significant cost savings in the below example. For a 50 MGD central treatment facility, the capital cost is $28 million with an O&M cost of $4.6 million per year. For a 5 MGD localized treatment facility, the capital cost and O&M cost were significantly less. This graph shows the cost curves used in this project. This cost curve is also part of the Excel model that was produced. As Xiaowen mentioned in the beginning of this session, this Excel model is available on a disk with the report. I want to quickly go over the inputs and outputs of the Excel model. For inputs, you will need the influent water quality, including the initial DBP concentrations. You also need to know what percent of the reservoir you want to treat. Next, you will need to know which types of treatment you want at the reservoir. You will also need to provide an estimate of your residence time from the reservoir to the farthest end user. Last, you will need to provide the current ENR CCI index so that your cost curves are up to date. The outputs include water quality of the treated effluent, and most importantly, the DBP concentration at the end user. It will also provide an approximate capital cost and annual O&M cost. I have one final note about the model here. This model should only be used as a guideline to determine if localized treatment can be effective for your specific utility. It should not be used to determine any concrete numbers. Now, Mao Feng will discuss how they used the pilot plant study to turn it into a full-scale application.
Thank you, Joe. After we learn the pilot study results, we proceed with the full-scale application and select the air stripping technology because it's the most cost-effective for GHN removal, and we don't have any HAA problems. We are actually using fine bubble aeration instead of the low-profile air strippers to further save our capital budget. As Laura mentioned earlier, after the economy slowed down, our hotspots tend to stay in place. Our water age and the THN problems become a longer-term issue. Because the THMs grows the most in our reservoirs, it makes sense to add treatment facilities at the reservoirs. Fine bubble aeration is a simple way to strip off THMs and it is a viable technology that does not require additional water pumps. This slide shows schematics of an aeration process. As water enters a reservoir basin, a portion of the THMs will be stripped out. As the water stays inside the basin, its THMs will be treated repeatedly as the water circulates inside the basin. The treated water is then leave the basin with a reduced level in total THM. Our approach is to use our model to identify critical reservoirs for THM treatment, then design and construct aeration systems. Special effort is required to address any environmental concerns
including air quality and blower noise. Finally, to maintain adequate residual and reservoir levels for safe and reliable services. Here's our ongoing Phase 1 project. The map shows our distribution pipelines. The color in red represents the modeled THM of greater than or equal to 72 micrograms per liter. So we see several areas or hotspots right off the map. The yellow box defines the first hotspot that we are going to remove with the Phase 1 project. This is a closer view of the hotspot. We have two reservoirs, Far Hills and Alta. Since the Alta reservoir serves the gateway to the entire hotspot, we decided to construct the aeration system at the Alta reservoir. The treated water then be pumped to the red zones and the Far Hills reservoir. Here's some key information about the Phase 1 project. The total reservoir volume is 40 million gallons. The treatment flow is in a range between 5 and 10 MGD, representing winter and summer conditions. The target removal is 20 to 40% depending on actual demand and operating conditions. The less treatment flow or longer residence time tends to increase the treatment efficiency. We are installing 6,000 fine bubble aerator or diffusers for a total design flow airflow of 12,000 standard cubic feet per minute. Maximum allowable noise is set at 84 dB since the site is surrounded by nice residential subdivisions. The total construction cost is $1.8 million and we estimate it to complete in the coming April. This chart shows an estimate on treatment performance in an isolated reservoir. The horizontal axis is the aeration time in hours, and the vertical axis is the percentage of removal. The dashed line shows the removal of four THM species. The solid line represents the total THM removal. The chart shows a quite significant THM removal over the continuous aeration time. If time allows, the total THM could be reduced by over 80%. We would like to point out that because different waters have different composition of four THM species, the treatment performance curve could be quite different. Additionally, chloroform appears to be easiest species to remove, and the bromoform is the hardest one to be stripped off. This chart shows the same data, but in terms of THM concentrations in the isolated reservoir. So the vertical axis is now TTHM. You may also notice that the TTHM reduction is much more significant at the beginning of the aeration. If the time allows, the total THM could be reduced from original 54 to below 10 micrograms per liter. This is an estimate on treatment performance after we place the reservoir in service and the design flows. The top line with the blue color represents the winter conditions before the treatment. 5 MGD flow is conveyed through the reservoir. Additional residence time or water age made by the reservoirs could increase the total THMs to over 70 micrograms per liter. As a result, the total THM at the next zone reservoir could be exceeding 80 micrograms per liter. The green line at the bottom shows the same condition except with the aeration. At a steady state of aeration, TTHM could be reduced from inlet concentration of 54 to about 30 micrograms per liter. The pink line at the middle represents a summer condition with a double flow rate and with aeration treatment. The TTHM could be reduced from 54 to about 40 micrograms per liter. Of course, the model needs to be validated and calibrated, and all the estimates will be verified and corrected after our field results. Our initial field results are scheduled to start at the end of this week, this month. To address potential air quality concerns, we contacted the County Department of Air Quality and Environmental Management and presented to them the calculated worst-case emission of VOC, organic compounds, and they successfully obtained a permit exemption letter for the project. This is a recent photo showing the air grates installed on the concrete reservoir floor. Very simple and straightforward. And this photo shows the air grates with the membrane diffusers on top of it. Been delayed, sorry. We are currently conducting air tests for necessary repairs and adjustments before the reservoir basin is filled up. We could see the air coming out of the diffusers with a detailed underwater photo. The actual size of the bubbles will be smaller after the reservoir is filled up. This photo shows the two blowers within the fence and an air pipe that conveys air into the reservoir basins. There is a small screen for operators to use on each blower with the operating information and buttons to push. We could also control the blowers remotely via the SCADA. Our next step is to complete the treatment plant construction by April 2010, complete the treatment test and performance evaluation, plan and implement operational strategies to successfully meet both storage and water quality objectives, and a plan for potential future projects. Now, go back to Bruce Johnson on the topic of a forward looking.
Okay, thank you, Mal. Where do we go from here? Let's spend a little bit of time and talk about implementation. To borrow a phrase from the pharmaceutical advertisements we see on television, you should ask some questions unique to your distribution system to determine if localized treatment is right for you. Of course, of paramount concern, especially in these times when we're all trying to stretch our dollars as far as possible as cost, if there are only a few areas of concern and a high level of treatment's not required, then it can make a lot of sense to consider localized treatment. Depending upon the method of treatment used, maintaining chlorine residual may be an issue. State regulators will likely require maintenance of a minimum residual at all times and locations within the distribution system. If a localized treatment process such as GAC is used, that also removes the chlorine residual, it may be necessary to modify or obtain a variance from the regulations. This could include ensuring that the design is a closed system, determining which microbial constituents are of concern, and establishing appropriate contact time for rechlorination, and providing standard operation and maintenance procedures for the treatment unit and for rechlorination. There could also be concerns about processes that are open to the atmosphere and potential for contamination. Again, to the extent possible, a closed system design would help to alleviate these concerns. Another consideration to be worked out with the state monitoring agency is the impact on the location and number of monitoring sites. If the DBPs are reduced in one location, then a new monitoring location may have to be selected. And this location would have to be the next worst site, but it would also have to be in compliance for the entire system to be in compliance. Possible impacts might be that states would require more sampling locations to verify that the system is in compliance. And there also might be monitoring requirements above and below a localized treatment facility to ensure its performance. We shouldn't forget about the air quality requirements. In case of air stripping, if it's used, it may require an air permit, or treatment of the air discharge stream may be required. In the case of Las Vegas Valley Water District, they found that air treatment was not required because the amounts were below the threshold. Finally, if something like BAC is used, there may be concern from regulatory agencies regarding the release of fines and the associated attached bacteria to the drinking water. While most of these bacteria are non-pathogenic and easily inactivated with chlorine, consideration should be given to minimizing the release of these fines. In overall summary, then, of our presentation this afternoon, the idea of treating only a portion of the distribution system, in fact, as we've seen in the presentations, only a portion of the flow through an individual reservoir can help to meet the Stage 2 disinfection byproduct rule limits. Through this study, there are some tools that are available to help model the treatment effectiveness, the reformation potential, and the comparative costs. The implementation and regulatory considerations, of course, will have to be addressed on a state and location-specific basis. And finally, based upon the results of this study, it appears that localized treatment should be considered as a viable option for meeting Stage 2 disinfection byproduct rule requirements. With that, we want to thank you again for your interest in the presentation this afternoon, and I'll turn the time over to Xiao Wen with the Research Foundation.
Thank you, Bruce. And before we move on to the Q&A session, I'd like to show you and additional resources to obtain information about Project 3103. In the next issue of the Foundation's publication, Drinking Water Research, there will be a case study article highlighting Project 3103. If you need more detailed information about this project, you can order the project report by going to the Foundation's website. www.waterresearchfoundation.org. Click on a quick project center on the column on the left, and then enter 3103 in the project number box. Click Project Profile / Order Reports. If you want a printed copy of the report, click Order Report. The printed copy comes with a CD that contains the model and the user's manual. If you want an electronic copy in PDF format, click Download PDF. You can go back to 3103's page, click Supporting Resources to download the model and the user's manual. Now let's move on to the Q&A session. I will read out the questions and a presenter or presenters will answer them. The first question: with the real-time water age model, how do you simulate equilibration of water age in the model? That is, what time frame and settings do you use from the SCADA?
In the real-time water age model is we started to build the accumulation of the water age since 2006. And we used the zero age to start with from the turnouts and start the tracking. So every time some flow change, storage volume change, and the water age will be recalculated. And from then, we have a database to tracking the water age. So this is no equilibrium to need for accumulating water age because we always using the live data. For the timeline, time frame, and the settings, we use the farm SCADAs. SCADAs capturing minute levels of flows and pumping on and off and reservoir levels and all the informations, and we use the hourly average for our flow demand calculations, and we use the exact pumping on and off times for the model purposes. So it's simulating in the corresponding real time. I hope I answered the question.
Okay, next question. How was the water age determined for the THM versus water age in January 2009?
Well, 2009, we doing the IDSE test. We sample, collect a sample system-wide. Those are the dots we presented. And also we use the IDSE guidelines for the water age calculations. So that's the correlations show on those charts.
Our next question, what was the seawater temperature in the Las Vegas Valley Water District pilot of airstripping and GAC, BAC? Same question for the tank aeration example.
For the pilot plant, the water temperature varies between a low of about 13 degrees C and a high of about 23 degrees C.
And for the aeration tanks, it was actually in the same reservoir. So this is all conducted in the Alta reservoir. So it would be the same temperature data.
Okay, next question. Did the research team measure and or give consideration to secondary water quality impacts of the localized treatment processes? For example, changes in pH and or dissolved oxygen and ORP. I'm wondering if changes in such parameters could yield long or even short-term impact on corrosion scaling potential, copper lead rule compliance, and or release of corrosion byproducts from pipe materials.
We looked at the impacts on pH and on dissolved oxygen, and they were fairly minor impacts. We did not try to extend this on to looking at the impacts on corrosion in pipelines or the implications that might come out of the lead and copper rule.
Next question. Why, during the pilot testing, you use air stripping first, followed by GAC-BAC? Either one is enough already.
Well, we were trying to get the look at the most options that we possibly could. One consideration that we had is if you had both a THM and an HAA-5 issue, that maybe you'd, if you had both of those issues, maybe you'd need to look at two treatment processes in combination. So you may look at air stripping and you may look at a GAC-BAC option. But more than anything, we set that up to look at as many options as we possibly could.
Next question. Was switching to chloramination considered by the Las Vegas Valley Water District instead of localized treatment?
We did do a rather extensive study, or rather the Southern Nevada Water Authority did a study of chloramination, GAC, as well as hotspot treatment. The conclusion of the study was that for the Southern Nevada Water Authority and all of its purveyor members, the cost of the hotspot treatment was less expensive than chloramination. We also had some concerns about nitrification in our system.
Next question. Do you have calcification problem for air stripping?
This was actually mentioned in our report. We talked about scale formation, and I believe we saw very little buildup. I cannot remember off the top of my head. Yes, we say in the report that there was very little buildup of scale on the trays, so we did not have a problem.
That's after 1 year. More than one year.
Yeah, it was more than a year, and we took the system apart, and there was very little deposition on any of the trays.
Next question. What is pH change due to diffused aeration, and is corrosion control treatment impacted?
Well, on the pilot plant, we had a little increase in pH. I think it went up to like 8.16, but it was like probably 0.2 increase. So we had a little bit of increase. And again, we haven't on the pilot plant. We weren't looking at corrosion control, so we didn't investigate that side of it.
The water district's project will be completed in April of 2010, so it has not started yet.
Next question. Was the effects of air in the water system evaluated relative to cavitation issues and customer complaints related to entrained air?
Theoretically, the air will be rising and released from the reservoirs, but we're going to monitor the dissolved airs and travel of the bubbles, and also the pumping maintenance, tracking those possible effects to the pumping, cavitation, and the corrosions. And we are keep an eye on everything. And our DO is already high and almost saturated in our reservoir anyway. So we're still looking at it, you know, with all the cameras, videos installed, and see if any bubbles get into the outlet of the reservoir.
Next question. Will the fine bubble diffusers be subjected to plugging and thus periodic cleaning?
Well, we hope not, because ideally those membrane diffusers will expand when you operating under the pressure of the airs, so nothing going to build up, but we will let everybody know after we turn this into operations.
Next question. Were the GAC BAC columns initially backwashed?
They weren't initially backwashed, but we did have an objective to see how long we would run between backwashing, and we set an initial criteria, and we found that we were just, based on head loss, we found that we just kept going and going and weren't getting that head loss, and so finally we started to see some problems with the column, so we started to go to a routine backwash. I think it was once every month we backwashed it, and that would be preferable rather than just having a backwashing based on head loss.
This is all the time we have for this webcast. We will provide answers to questions that we were not able to get to. The answers, along with the full download of the entire webcast, will be available on the Water Research Foundation's website later this week. I'd like to thank the presenters, Bruce, Laura, Mao, and Joseph. Last but not least, thank you, viewers, for attending today's Water Research Foundation webcast. This concludes the webcast.